Hey, Cypher here. Real quick before we get started, this was actually a paper I presented at an academic conference called the Western Historical Association. Given that YouTube doesn't support educational content, I doubt they will this either. Even though that would be required if they want to call themselves an educational platform. After all, they did the same thing with the last conference paper I presented and then turned into a YouTube video. Heck, the original conference panel was actually sponsored by Southern Nevada Mining. Get that. And it is not nice towards Southern Nevada Mining. But that would require YouTube to actually know how advertisers work, which they don't. Sorry, but I have to add another note before we get started. And it's a bit of a change in tone. But something happened while I was editing this video. I just found out that one of the presenters who was with me on that panel died of a heart attack. His name was Phil Brigandi. He was a close friend of the family and basically an uncle to me. And he has been a huge part of my life, quite literally, since I was born. Phil was the most published historian I know of, and a really good one at that. I remember driving from Las Vegas to Reno and back, just him and I, and we somehow never ran out of things to talk about. So I dedicate this episode to Phil Brigandi. He'll be sorely missed. Around the turn of the 20th century, Southern Nevada convulsed with a series of murders. They were perpetrated by local Paiutes without any known motives. As a recent murderer in Las Vegas surpassed the worst of these so-called renegade Indians, we may re-examine this strain of violence from a century ago. Important parallels can be drawn to the greater context of these murderers to understand their circumstances without having to delve into the murky depths of their individual motives. They all have specific stories, legends, and misconceptions surrounding them. But the greater context of racial violence explains these murders far better than their individual instances. Southern Nevada mining in places like El Dorado Canyon began as a refuge from the Civil War, but violence wove its way into the history there anyways. Americans in the area discovered gold in the 1850s, but miners did not work it until the early 1860s. As such, many folks went to this desolate outpost on the Colorado to escape the possibility of being enlisted in the Civil War. Though there certainly were sympathies for either side of the war between the states, these never manifested themselves more than a couple banners perforated with bullet holes. Though this tiny end of what was then New Mexico territory was largely unaffected by the war, it speaks to the readiness of the meager few white inhabitants to bear arms. Even once Arizona was separated and then this chunk of land handed over to Nevada, the local whites managed to maintain peace in El Dorado, despite being in a state of virtual anarchy. That anarchy caused much of these stories to be whispered tales, barely remembered long after their occurrences. Deeper still was the violence stretching back centuries, perpetrated upon local Paiutes. Long before Jedediah Smith blazed a trail through the territory in 1826, Utes raided into what would become Southern Nevada. Utes took Paiutes as slaves, many being sold into the burgeoning slave markets in Spanish New Mexico. Once Antonio Armijo established the Old Spanish Trail 3 years after Smith, which was not old, Spanish, nor even much of a trail, the Utes raided into California as part of a multicultural group called Los Chaguanosos. The Utes among them, as they were taking horses to sell, raided through this section of land for sustenance and destroyed the local economy for decades to come. By the 1860s, the Paiutes were severely weakened from this long history of intertribal violence, something which the U.S. government took advantage of. In 1870, as part of President Grant's peace policy, the federal government created a massive reservation for Southern Paiutes. It incorporated much of what Clark County is today, but shrunk year after year until 1872 left a meager allotment on the Muddy River, called Moapa. Local Paiutes refused to be corralled to such a tiny piece of land, so they generally acted as though the reservation did not exist. The Indian agent in charge complained in 1880, saying, "The Indians are scattered over the surrounding country for 200 miles around, eking out a precarious existence by working, begging, root digging, and insect eating, a life not of their choice. Not one Indian has resided on the reservation to be demoralized by the sad spectacle thus presented by the white man's waning culture." Instead, they took menial jobs throughout southern Nevada, as more white people arrived to establish ranches and mines. Paiutes were in dire straits. With increased mining, a strain of violence began that did not end until after the First World War. Up in Pioche, there was some fighting between the miners and Paiutes there, related to some killing and reprisals beginning in 1864 around Panaca. They even abandoned the town in the 1870s to Paiute raiding. Eventually, the miners prevailed, but at the cost of the already beleaguered southern Paiute tribe. Down in El Dorado, the beginning of violence came in 1874, when a group from one mine jumped the other, with two murdered in the process. The jumpers left the defender's corpse in a partially covered well and buried their compatriot nearby, where they both remain today. Years later, a witness to these troubles said, "If ever there was a haunt on this earth, Jim Jones haunted the old Tchatacup and Queen City mines." The place was indeed haunted, for this became the first of many murders to come. One of these killers was named William Piede, who became the bad man of El Dorado. He murdered at least two more men, including one by poisoning. He was never prosecuted, though he was eventually ran out of town in 1887. But El Dorado was too far from Pioche to get a lawman that far south. Before then, Piede managed to convince a Paiute to assassinate his partner in a merchant venture while his partner was taking a boat across the Colorado. This killer's name is only known to us as Loco, and he too was allowed to live on despite his murder. The permissiveness of murder took its toll eventually, when a Paiute named Mawawich killed a postman over a game of cards. Only a year prior, two miners shot each other over such an issue. But since they were equally to blame for shooting each other, no one retaliated against the one who survived his wounds. Mawawich was alienated by his race, and thought to be at fault for needlessly killing the only federal official El Dorado would regularly see. The miners sought revenge. They enlisted the local tribe to catch the killer, who sent a cousin to do the deed. Once it was done, this man brought back Mawawich's distinctive hand with a missing finger to certify the task's completion. His name was Avote. Avote must have allowed the hate to well up inside him, for 5 years later, he went on a killing spree in the middle of the night. He shot dead four miners and a porter before slipping into the desert, bringing the number dead to the count of years he had waited. Many claims of causation exist, but none are reliable. For instance, one said this mass shooting was premeditated and a result from jealousy over a squaw. As one chronicler said, this brought the lands along the Colorado to the brink of open warfare between Indians and whites. People thought the local Paiutes were more numerous and better armed than the miners, so the miners once again enlisted the tribe to go after its own, but also listed a bounty. A pair of men collected the bounty from one of the mine's foremen only a day later. Though southern Nevada had been a starkly violent place for decades, Avote seemed to be a breaking point, the first of the renegade Indians. The next came around the same time by the name of Mouse. He was so named because of the fact that he was very sly and keen. Although he was a good workman, the other Indians feared and hated him, as he had made threats that he would kill someone. His first crime was to steal a Winchester and a horse on the Arizona side of the Colorado. After fording the river and thereby killing his stolen horse, he continued to steal and brought some would-be prospectors with him from the Benelli Ferry, two of which were found murdered by the same Winchester. The treachery of Mouse, the renegade, sent southern Nevada into another frenzy, building a large posse to chase him down, but to no avail. He popped in and out of knowledge for years, periodically caught stealing or blamed for various acts of mischief throughout southern Nevada. Finally, he stole a horse from the Benelli Ferry in 1898, and a posse was formed again. This time, they gave chase for several days, periodically exchanging gunfire, and managed to travel for more than 100 miles. The final shootout took place north of the Valley of Fire. As one of the pursuants said, "When we got to him, he was dead. He had been hit 3 times, once through the head and twice through the body. The Indians in the posse shot him several times after we had come up to him." Southern Nevada breathed a sigh of relief, acting as though the troubles were over. William Clark's railroad founded the city of Las Vegas 7 years later, which seemed to bring peace to the region, but another so-called renegade was biding his time. He was half Kokopa or Paiute and white, with a distinctive limp, said to be a grumbler as a result, hence his name, Kehoe. 2 people in El Dorado were found murdered in 1910, purposefully drawing parallels to a Vote and Mouse, and an article in the Las Vegas Age said, "They may have fallen victim to savage treachery." It spoke to the separation of violence whites of Clark County still felt a decade after they dispatched Mouse. Later authors claimed Kehoe was one of the Indians who hunted down a Vote. Much like Mouse, Kehoe fled into the desert, but more akin to Avote, he kept killing. He quickly became a boogeyman of Southern Nevada, and was blamed for every unsolved theft or murder into the 1920s. By his final 3 corroborated murders in 1919, he had a bounty posted by Nevada and Arizona for 25 victims. Posse after posse went after Kehoe, but none succeeded. Some claimed to see him well into the 1930s. Legends quickly developed around the last of the renegade Indians. One article in 1928 described him as Kehoe, notorious renegade Indian, outlaw and murderer, cunning far beyond his brother Paiutes. Like a desert phantom, he was felt but seldom seen. Some even sowed doubt of Kehoe's complicity. The $2,500 bounty certainly helped people continue theorizing. It came to the point that a form of social banditry soon enveloped the murderer, when the newspaper said, "Who can say that Kehoe was not self-appointed to avenge his family's honor on the white race?" This idea, while not found in primary sources, who were more likely to speak of the insane murder lust of Kehoe, has nonetheless remained. Harry Reid expounded it decades later in his poorly contrived History of Searchlight, where he said, "It is no wonder that Kehoe's fellow Indians helped him." Reed even imagines an unsourced revenge motive for Kehoe not being paid. None of these claims can be substantiated, and many are outright contradicted by the newspapers and logs from the time, especially considering the few Paiutes Kehoe actually murdered. They're not likely to help somebody who was murdering them. All of this was put to rest in 1940 when Kehoe was finally found, along with many artifacts to confirm his murders, and having lived well into the 1930s. This is not where his story ends, though, for the desert desiccated his corpse. The Los Angeles Times dubbed him the Mad Mummy. After a brief squabble over ownership of the remains by supposed family members of Kehoe, he wound up in the Elks Lodge. They put him and the artifacts in a grotesque display for decades related to the El Dorado celebrations. He even ended up on national television, which furthered the legend surrounding him with a piece about his supposed hidden treasure.
"For some 30 years, he used a never-ending source of gold nuggets to buy his food and supplies. Nuggets that came from a hidden mine somewhere here in the El Dorados. A strange story? Yes, but stranger still is the fact that it all occurred just a short distance from one of America's most exciting vacation spots."
After El Dorado days ended, he went on an odyssey throughout the Las Vegas Valley, first spending time in various people's garages, then stolen and distributed about the wash for a rather hilarious cold case, possibly buried for a short time before ending in the University of Nevada Las Vegas's collections, where he lived his afterlife in the Barrick Museum's archives for a few more years. While this continued, his legend grew unchecked by historians. Hence Harry Reid's mistaken portrayal. A Pahrump lawyer brought him from UNLV and buried Kehoe out in Cathedral Canyon over the hump in 1986, finally putting the renegade to rest after 75 years on the lam. As Don McLean sang of a similar story,
"Because though he died long ago, he was buried today. A man who found more love.
though the legends of Paiute revenge that grew alongside the renegade Indians are mostly without merit, they have a grain of truth to them worth considering as Las Vegas enters another strain of violence. The Las Vegas Age said of Kehoe, the Indian who had formerly operated the mine had been forced into the background. We may not know if they were actually operating the mine, but they certainly moved to the background after 1870. The Pioche miners who fought Southern Paiutes did so to maintain territory. One historian says, the organization of a mining district forever stripped the land from Paiute hands. Miners pushed Paiutes to the margins, through coercion and violence, relegating them to menial labor. The tribe as a whole receded further into the desert to avoid the violence of Nevada mining. This legacy continued into the renegade period. Avote, Mouse, and Kehoe were all emblematic of this troubled history. Ranchers and miners employed them as wood gatherers and packers. The renegades all appear to only distantly connect to the tribe they belonged to. All of this was a legacy of their stripped land and deeper history of violence perpetrated against them. We cannot know their true motives for murdering so many people, but a strain of violence is easy to discern. Richard Maxwell Brown says, American violence owes much to the dead weight of unsolved problems from the past. This dead weight was the violence of racial exclusion that created Southern Nevada mining, and the ratcheting up of murderousness by these renegades appears to be part of a general pattern. It took Kehoe hiding for decades to end it. They were probably aware of each other's deeds, and Kehoe merely was able to keep it all going. As he hid away, his rampage turned to legend, some of whom saw it as redemption for the misdeeds of the past. In a way, that is the case, but only in a broader context of violence, rather than the immediate causation. We can read today's spree killers in much the same way. Las Vegas recently faced the worst of these murderers, who killed 58 people on October 1st, 2017. The motive is unknown, but there is no need to discover their individual motives to understand the broader context. We may not be capable of seeing that pattern in the present, but we can, at the very least, understand that it is there before resorting to conspiracy theories or trying to divorce each instance from one another. Broader issues of race, class, and gender are perhaps the most conspicuous route to take. The renegades certainly have racial and class distinctions, as well as the obvious masculinity of violence in general. They show us a way to understand the present strain. During the naming of the town of Nelson, which was named after one of Avote's victims only a few years before Kehoe began his rampage, the Las Vegas Age said, someday, all history of the desert will be written, but half those facts will have been forgotten. Some have never been known, except to those who cannot tell.